Today we start a series entitled Fan or Follower. All of our New Life locations are going to be preaching on this same topic, and all of our small groups for 3 weeks are going to be talking about this same topic, the difference between a fan and a follower. And how many of you know there's a big difference between a fair weather fan and a diehard follower? Yeah. There's a big difference between a fair weather fan. In fact, I looked up fair weather fan in the dictionary. And here's what it says about a fair weather fan. It says, fair weather fan are, they are friends when you are successful, but not when you fail. Sounds like some of your friends, right? They're fair weather fans. They're on board when the team is winning and when people are celebrating, but they're not there when the team is losing miserably, when the weather's nasty, when no one else is in the bleachers. They're not there. Well, because they're fair weather fans. And some of you, when it comes to sports, are a little bit fair weather. You show up at the playoffs if they're doing well. But during the year, if they're doing bad, like, you're not going to show up at all to weather the bad weather and watch a losing team. And so I was thinking about that. I was thinking about the fact that there are some diehard fans and there are some fans that are, well, just, I'm not really into it that much, but I'll show up when the team is winning. In fact, I never had met this brother before, and I wasn't really planning on doing it this morning, but I actually ran, and someone told me the biggest fan that I've ever met in the world happens to be a Cubs fan. And all right, we have some. And I just never met this fan, but I found out he's one of the biggest fans for the Cubs that we know, and it's Ronnie Woo Woo. Ronnie, why don't you stand up? Come here a second, come here. I didn't even know Ronnie Woo Woo was going to be here this morning, but, you know, I saw his Cubs outfit, and I thought, you know, I understand that this brother, like, he is a big, big fan. Someone told me you have not missed a Cubs game in how long? Is that true?
It's been a long time, long, long time, about 50 or 59.
About 50 or 59 since 1959? Well, is that a hardcore fan or what? That's a hardcore fan. And, Ronnie, have there been days when you have shown up and you were a little bit sick?
No, well, with God's help, the Spirit of the Lord, God liked, you know, it's been a blessing.
Okay.
And I've been supporting the Cubs, win or lose. You know, every team wins 60, lose 60, 60 up for grabs, but you go through life, you know, cause nothing to be nice.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. When's the last time the Cubs were at a World
Series?
World Series.
1945.
And they haven't won since 1945, but even though they haven't won, you have been there. Man, I don't call you a fair weather fan. I call you a diehard fan. Okay, so last thing I'm going to do. You are famous. There's even a bobblehead, Ronnie Woo Woo bobblehead. And you are famous for a certain kind of noise that you make at all the games. Could you kind of help us with that today?
Sure. Well, I'm losing my voice, but I've God been blessing. Cub, 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 world, Siri, world, Russo, Russo, Brian, 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 cub, 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 Russo, Russo, Maya, me and you, Moonlight, Worldlife, me and you, and your buddy, and bless Jesus too. Don't forget that guy. He started it all.
I love that. You hear at the end, he said, and I bless Jesus too. Thank you. Let's give it up for Wani Woo Woo. Thank you. God bless you, brother. Now, Ronnie, he's a diehard fan. He's not a fair weather fan, he's a diehard fan. I mean, he's there every single game. And here's what I've discovered. I've discovered that when it comes to spirituality, when it comes to our walk with God, that there are many of us that would fall into the category of fair weather fans instead of diehard followers of Jesus. In fact, there was a recent survey that was done across America asking people that check the category of Christian in the survey, would they consider themselves more fans of Christianity or would they consider themselves more followers of Christ? And 75% of those that responded to the survey that consider themselves Christians checked the category that they would consider themselves more fans of Christianity than they would followers of Jesus Christ. So I believe that we live overall in a in an American culture where many people that would have choices, if you have choices between Buddhist, Muslim, Hindu, New Age, or atheist or agnostic, that out of all those categories, you would actually choose the box that says Christian. But the question is, how Christian really are you? Because there's a big difference between being a fan and actually an authentic follower of Jesus Christ. And I want to talk to you about the difference for the next 3 weeks. If you are here saying, I've always considered myself a Christian, I've always believed in Christ since I was a little child, I have a crucifix in my home, I have a Bible in my drawer somewhere, I was taken to a church when I was a child, I attend Easter and Christmas services, and if I were pressed hard to mark a category on my Facebook page, I would say Christian. The Bible tells us that Jesus had many followers when he was on earth. And last week I talked to you about in John chapter 6 that there was a great multitude of people that were following Jesus. In fact, they were following Jesus, and Jesus did a miracle where he turned a couple of loaves and fishes into a massive mega meal. And he was able to feed 5,000 people. And then the crowd got super excited about that their needs were being met. Everybody's happy over a meal. How about it? You want to make some people happy when they're coming over to your house? Just give them a meal. You want to make, I see this all the time with mothers, you want to quiet your child down when they're antsy and crying, and what do? Give them a sucker. And then suddenly it appeases them. Jesus fed 5,000 people, and then the crowd started following Jesus, not because they necessarily believed that Jesus was the Messiah, not necessarily because they wanted to follow him, but they started coming around Jesus because they felt like Jesus was meeting their needs. And Jesus crossed over to the river, crossed over to the lake. The disciples continued. All this multitude of people followed after him. And then finally Jesus turned to them and said, you're not following me because of the miracles that I do or because you believe I'm the Son of God. You're following me because I fed you. And then Jesus turns around and he gives them a hard message. In essence, Jesus says, if you're going to follow me, you need to participate. I'm the Son of God. It's going to cost you something. And as Jesus said this hard message, the Bible says that many of his disciples followed him no more. That many of the people that were following in the crowd, when they heard the hard message, then they just said, well, I didn't sign up for that. I mean, I thought I was going to get another free meal out of this. I don't want that hard stuff. I don't think I'm into this. And they walked away. Thousands of people walked away from Jesus. And then Jesus looked and turned to his 12 disciples and he said to them, are you going to leave me too? And Peter looked at Jesus and said, Lord, if we leave you, where will we go? Only you have words of eternal life. And at that moment, something extraordinary happened. There was a separation between the fair weather fans and the hardcore followers. Today I want to talk to you about the difference between a fan and a follower, and I want you to start to begin to analyze and evaluate your life and ask yourself, am I simply a fan of Jesus, or am I really a follower of Jesus? Jesus told a parable, and I want you to take your Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 13. There's a parable referred to as the parable of the seed and the sower. It's actually found in three of the Gospels. There are four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And it's found in Matthew, it's found in Mark, and it's found in Luke. The same parable, just told by different people that heard the parable told. And so, if it's repeated three times, it must be of impact importance if three of the Gospels remembered it and included it. It's a simple parable, but with a powerful, powerful message to it. And I believe that this parable really is telling us the difference between the true follower of Jesus and those that are simply fans or sympathizers of Jesus. And so I'm going to read to you out of Matthew chapter 13, the parable that Jesus gives us. It says in Matthew chapter 13, verse 1, that same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and he sat in it, while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, and he gave them a parable. He said, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. And some fell on the rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly. But because the soil was shallow, but when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. And other seeds fell among the thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. And still another seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop 100, 60, 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let him hear. Word of the Lord. So let me talk to you a little bit about this parable that Jesus explains to his disciples about the difference between a fair weather fan and a hardcore follower. Jesus gives us an image. A parable is a picture or an image or a story that has deep meaning to it, a simple story with deep meaning. So he tells the story about a farmer. In that agricultural environment, everybody around there knew about farming. Today, here in Chicago, we don't have a lot of people that know a lot about farming. How many of you have maybe a little tomato garden in your house that you work, or you work on flowers? Anybody here? All right, we got a few people that know about seeds and planting. So Jesus really explains it this way. He said there's a sower. The sower represents God and the people that carry the gospel. So the sower has a bag of seeds. The seeds represent the gospel of Jesus, the life-changing gospel of Jesus. And he said, a farmer goes out, and he has a bag of seeds, and he starts throwing the seeds around because he wants the seed to produce a plant that produces fruit. And so he goes out, and he sows a seed. Now, the seed is good. There's nothing wrong with the seed. The seed is the gospel. It's the same everywhere, that Jesus Christ was all God, became all man to die for us on a cross, and if we repent, believe, and are baptized, we can transform our lives and become a follower of His. That's the essence of the gospel. It's good news. The seed is the same everywhere, but the heart that the seed lands on is different. So he describes four different kinds of people that are equated to soil. If you're taking notes, write this down. This is the first one is the hard heart. Look at what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 13. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. And then in verse 19, Jesus explains what that picture is. He said, when anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in the heart. This is the seed that's sown along the path. So Jesus says, there are certain people, and even this morning in this auditorium, or in a small group, or when you're sharing your faith at work, that there's someone that will be sitting there, and they'll hear the gospel clearly presented. They'll understand intellectually the message of the gospel. But as the gospel is being preached and shared, there's a battle that's happening inside of them. The gospel, they hear it, but their heart is hard. Their heart is hard. The seed doesn't get inside of their heart because although they understand it with their mind, they're not grasping it with their heart or with their spirit. In fact, in Luke, it tells us, in Luke chapter 8, it says that when the seed goes out, it's trampled, and then the bird comes and picks it out. Listen to me. So I believe that many people, even in this auditorium, they struggle with accepting the gospel because there are things that cause your heart to be hard. You fight whether the gospel is true. You may fight secularism that says, well, I believe science is contrary to faith. You may fight relativism that believes, well, it's all relative, depends on your environment. Truth is not really truth or absolute, it's all relative. You may fight pluralism, which believes, well, every way is good and every way leads to God. There's not just one way. There's a whole bunch of ways, and they're all pretty much equally the same. You may fight paganism, which basically you embrace some other religious form or belief or some other God. Or you may fight hedonism, which says, well, that sounds good, but I'm all about making myself happy. So if it doesn't make me more happy, I don't want it. There may be a lot of battles that you have in your mind fighting the message of the gospel. But the bottom line is that some people hear the gospel and they're wrestling with it. They're doubting it. They don't quite accept it. And while they're doubting it and don't quite accept it, there's a spiritual battle that's happening. And the enemy, which refers to the bird or Satan, comes in and steals the gospel out of their heart. And so they walk away from a place like this, although they've heard the gospel clearly explained, they reject it, it doesn't change them, it doesn't have an effect, and they just go on with their life. That's the seed that falls on the hard ground. Why don't people understand the gospel? Well, I don't believe it's because the gospel is so difficult to understand. I believe it's because of what it says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 18, that some people are darkened in their understanding and because of the hardness of their heart. I was watching a program recently on colorblindness. And when someone is colorblind, they actually cannot see the difference between colors, even though it's apparent and obvious to everyone else around them. This condition results from the absence of color-sensitive pigment in the cone cells of the retina, the nerve layer at the back of the eye. So when someone is colorblind, they can see the bright color orange, but they can't tell that it's orange. Other people see it, but they can't. It's obvious, but it's not obvious to them because they're blinded to color. It's the same with the gospel. Two people will be sitting next to each other. They will hear the same message. And one person will understand it and grasp it and weep and say, that's what I want, that's what I need. God, I want to give my life to you. I've understood the gospel. And the other person that's hearing the very exact same message can sit there not moved, not touched, not propelled in any way, because one person has seen it clearly, but the other person has not seen it at all. Are you tracking with me? I remember years ago talking to a young man who I had led to Christ. He came out of a bad background. He had been a drug dealer in Bridgeport, and he couldn't come to church because he had three DUIs and he had to do community service on Sundays. But when I talked to him there the very first time about the gospel, I went to his house to talk to another roommate of his, and his other roommate was like, I don't want to have anything to do with that, dude. But this guy was listening, and he asked questions, and he wanted to hear, and he actually gave his life to Christ right there very sincerely, and immediately understood the gospel, and immediately started changing his life radically. And so he was so excited about the gospel and his change that he went and began to witness to all of his friends and all of his family members as well. And about 2 months into his walk with God, he sat down with me and he was so frustrated. He said, Pastor, I don't understand this. I have the best news in the entire world, a news that's changed my life. I mean, people see that I'm a different person, that I'm not the same guy that I was before, that God has melted my hardness to softness, taken me out of drugs. My lifestyle has changed. I'm living for God, learning the word. I'm so excited. And I'm telling my family about it, and he said, they just don't get it. He says, I don't understand how they can be so dense, how they can be so cold that they don't understand. What's wrong with them, he said to me. And I said, his name was Jose. I said, Brother Jose, think back a little bit. Do you remember how many times people talked to you about God when you were not ready to receive it and you thought they were loony? He started to think back. He said, yeah, one time I spit at a guy and one time I cursed at a guy. And I said, exactly, because maybe your family is not ready to accept it because they were blind like you were blind. But don't give up, because the day will come that maybe the soil will change and they will be ready to accept the gospel of Jesus Christ as well. So don't give up. Keep persevering. Keep sowing seeds, because the day will come maybe when their heart is ready to accept it. So we have the hard heart, the seed that falls in the ground and it doesn't penetrate, it doesn't take root. And then the second seed that Jesus tells us about is what I would call not the hard heart, but the second seed is what I would call the shallow heart. In verse 5 it says, and then some seed fell on the rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow, but when the sun came out, the plants were scorched and they withered because they had no root. In verse 20, Jesus explains it. The one who received the seed that fell on the rocky place is the man who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since he has no root, he lasts only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, he quickly falls away. So this is the person, the shallow heart person. This is the person that's in a gathering like this. And he hears the gospel of Jesus Christ presented, the message of the gospel. And this person immediately is touched by it. They hear the gospel and they're excited about the hope, the joy, the message of forgiveness. And immediately they say, this is what I've been waiting for. This is what I've been wanting. And maybe at an altar call, they come forward and they're weeping and saying, yes, I want God in my life. I've been waiting for this message. It's the best thing that could ever happen to me. and they pray and they get up and they say, I want to join a Bible study. Is there one on Tuesday? Yeah. But is there one on Thursday? I want to go on Thursday as well. Is there one on Saturday? I want to join 3 Bible studies. I want to buy 5 Bibles because I want every version. I want to go to a prayer meeting. I'm hungry to learn about God. I'm excited about my new life in Christ. Hey, I think God may be calling me to be a missionary. Oh, this is so great, so exciting. I'm excited to live for God all the way. And they are full of zeal and enthusiasm about following Christ and their new life, and they love the fellowship and the worship, and they come early and they stay late, and they talk to all their friends about what it is to follow Christ because they are so excited about it. But a month into it, their girlfriend says, if you're going to be a Jesus freak, fanatic, follower, I don't want to be with you anymore. The family starts giving this person a rough time. The coworkers start making fun. People stop inviting them to the birthday party. They suddenly realize, I got to be honest at work and I've been lying. And suddenly they start feeling a pressure. There's a price to pay, a cost. People aren't calling them like they used to. Friends are making fun. The girlfriend breaks up. And then 3 months into it, their exuberance and joy suddenly has given way to, well, this is hard. I don't know, is this hard? And in 6 months, you look around and they're nowhere to be found. And someone asks, hey, what happened to that person that was all excited? I don't know. They disappeared. Haven't seen them in months. What went wrong? Let me tell you what went wrong. The Bible says that the seed falls on the ground and it springs up quickly, but when persecution or cost or difficulty sets in, that person walks away because they're not ready to pay the price of following Jesus. How many of you know what I'm talking about? You've seen that happen. How many of you have had a friend or family member that's happened to you too? Yeah. You know what I compare it to? I compare it to the person that goes out to shop, has an old beat up car, and they say, I'm ready for a new car. They see a commercial. So they look around for the car, and then they find the car they finally like. They, wow, a Nissan Murano. I want it. It's got the leather seats. And the car dealer says, come, sit in it. And you sit down, and it's way not like your 1998 Chevy that's rusted and smells, stains all over. And they say, sit on it. Whoa, this feels nice. Grab the steering wheel. Nah, nice. Hey, check out the Wi-Fi. Isn't that cool? And the GPS that's built into the dashboard. Hey, put it in reverse. See the camera? Oh, man, this is what I've been waiting for. Man, you look so good in that car. Picture yourself driving in the neighborhood. People aren't going to look at, oh, there it comes. They're going to say, well, who's that? Oh, wow, they've really prospered in life. And you're like, yeah, it's what I've been waiting for. I'm so excited about it. I want it. What do I do? They say, well, look at this, you know, blah, 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 blah. It's going to cost blah, 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 blah. Yeah. Where do I sign? Right there. So you sign and you drive off the lot with the car. You're so excited. You drive into the old neighborhood just hoping people will see you. You roll down the window and crank the music just hoping that someone says, hey, what are you doing in the neighborhood? Oh, nothing, just, you know, coming by. You drive by that girlfriend that you've been jealous for a while, and you just kind of drive around the block a couple times so you see her in the yard and you say, hi. And you're just so excited about that car, so pumped up about that car until the first payment arrives in the mail. You look at the payment and say, $450. That's a lot of money. Well, why didn't they tell me about this? I can't afford $450 a month. Didn't no one tell me about the cost of it? So you struggle to pay it. You go from a latte to just a coffee at Starbucks just to try to squeeze it out there. You're really, really trying to cut corners to make it, and it's a cost, and you don't go to the theater at that night. You stop eating out, and you're really trying to make the payments. The second month comes, and you say, this is way too high of a price. I'm going to skip this month and make it up next month. And so you skip the second month, and then you skip the third month, and then you skip the fourth month because you say, this price is way too high. I can't afford this. I have to change my whole lifestyle to be able to afford this car. I have to give up eating out on the weekends, and I really love this, and I can't shop at Macy's. I have to go to the secondhand store, and this is going to really change my lifestyle. I think the cost is too high, and you look out the window one day, and there's a repo man there. And then your mother tells you, well, honey, didn't you count the cost and try to figure out if you could afford this before you signed on the dotted line? Hello. Some of us are like that with Jesus. Oh, I like the forgiveness, the future, the glory, the people, the worship, the positive message. This is so good. I want it. Where do I sign? Where do I jump in? How do I become involved? Uh-oh, a month later, I got to pay a price. Like, I like the good stuff about Jesus, the power upstairs, the forgiveness, the feeling, the joy. But I didn't know that there was a cost to pay. The crucified life, the deny yourself, the forgive other people, the give up temptation, all that stuff. I didn't know I had to, like, give up clubbing and partying, getting drunk on the weekend, snorting a line of cocaine and sleeping with my girlfriend. I didn't know about all that stuff. You see, I want the Jesus, but I don't want to pay a price. I don't want to have to give up stuff. This is the seed that falls away. Because it's the shallow heart, it springs up quickly, but it doesn't last. That's a fan, not a follower. Number three seed that Jesus talks about is what I would call the divided heart. So you have the hard heart, the shallow heart, and you have the divided heart. The divided heart, it says, that the other seed fell among the thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. And then Jesus explains it in verse 22. The one who received the seed that fell among the thorns is the man who hears the word, but the worries of life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke it, making it unfruitful. In Luke, he says, the worries of life, the deceitfulness of riches, and the pursuit of pleasure choke it out. So this is the person that the seed is planted, and they say yes to Jesus. Yeah, I want to follow him. I like the message of the cross. I want forgiveness. My past washed away. And they start out pretty well in life, but as they go into life, they realize that, well, suddenly God is asking to be the center of their life, but yet they're pursuing their career and buying the house and doing the car, and God is sort of competing. They have to decide, what's going to be my main goal in life? Is it financial prosperity, or does God trump my financial prosperity? Worries of this life, the deceitfulness of riches, or the pursuit of pleasure. Suddenly the person says, I want Jesus, but I also want all these other things, and it starts competing. In the beginning you say, well, I want both. I'm not going to give up on God, but I also want to hang on to this. And there comes a point in time where you reach a crossroads where you have to decide, is it Jesus or is it this that's going to rule your life? This is the 22-year-old guy that finally comes to church and hears the message. And he says, he has a vision of what it means to be a follower of Christ and says, I want to change. I want to give my life to Christ. And he gets a Bible, gets the word, and he sees himself as becoming a different kind of man. He likes the message of the gospel. He connects with a new group of people. but he also feels like, I'm 22. I still have a lot of life to live. This Jesus stuff is kind of cramping the style of my weekends. And so he lasts the first 3 weekends, but he hasn't really counted the cost yet. He starts saying, well, I want to have fun too. And the old buddies keep calling him to club some more. And he's like, well, I don't know, that's a good environment for me. But they keep pulling him. And so he finds himself going there, and he can't snort that line of cocaine anymore. And he gets tempted by the girlfriends that they used to sleep with, a couple of them rotating around on the weekends before. And now he can't do that anymore. And so he says, well, what I'll do is I'll keep Jesus, but I'll still keep pleasure as well. And I'll do a little bit of both. I know I'm not fully committed to Christ, but eventually the pursuit of pleasure will drag him away from God. And he'll wake up one day and realize I'm completely away from God because he had to make a choice. That's a fan, not a follower. Because the weeds grow up, it says, and choke the plant so that it doesn't produce any fruit. I want you to hear me because this is really important. The first 3 seeds explained in this parable have one thing in common. None of them produced any fruit. They started out, the first one is a rejecter. The next 2 are acceptors, but they have no fruit. And then Jesus says there's a 4th seed. Thank God for the 4th seed. There is a 4th seed. And Jesus explains it in Matthew chapter 13, verse 8. He says, still, other seed fell on good soil. Say it out loud, good soil. Oh, thank God for good soil. Good soil doesn't mean good people. Good soil simply means a heart that's ready to change, ready to receive, a heart that's prepared. So the last seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 160 or 30 times that which was sown. And then Jesus explains it in verse 23. But the one who received the seed that fell on the good soil is the man who hears the word and understands it. And he produces a crop yielding 100, 60, 30 times what was sown. See, this seed falls on good soil. In the beginning, it's hard to tell the difference between the rocky soil, the trampled soil, and the thorny soil, because it all looks the same in the beginning. You can't really tell the difference in the beginning when people come to Christ, whether they're a fan or a follower, because they all tend to look a little bit the same. Only time will tell us who is truly a fan or a follower. But this seed grows up, and this seed is the only seed out of the 4 that produces fruit. Fruit. You see, the big difference in all of these seeds is that there's only one that produces fruit. The rest are fruitless. And Jesus says in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus says, not everybody who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. In fact, he says, some people will do miracles in my name, cast out demons in my name, and when they come before me, I will say, I don't know you, away from me. That means that there's some people that hang around the Christian culture that are going to hear when they come before God, I don't know who you are. That means that there's some people that are actually on stages and pulpits and preaching the word or even doing extraordinary things that are not authentic followers of Christ. That means that there's churches that have people that come on a regular basis to church and bring their Bibles that are going to hear one day before God, I don't know you, because a church doesn't make you right with God. Hello. A denomination doesn't make you right with God. Hello. Having a Bible doesn't make you right with God. The fact that you pray doesn't make you right with God. The difference between the good seed and the bad seed is one word, fruit. So you say, Pastor, well, what is fruit, man? Because I want it. Tell the person beside you, be fruitful, not fruity. Come on, we want to have fruit, not be fruity. What does fruit mean? Well, I'm wrapping this up real fast, so hang with me. Listen, I believe that there's three types of fruit that are indicated in Scripture. One is indicated in Matthew chapter 3, verse 8. It's the fruit of repentance. Matthew 3, verse 8 says, produce fruit in keeping with repentance. Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. That means that when you repent, you change. That when you say, I'm leaving the world behind and embracing Christ, you change. You cannot legitimately, authentically repent of your old lifestyle and keep living your old lifestyle. When you repent, you leave it behind. Oh, it doesn't mean that you're perfect. It doesn't mean that you don't struggle. It doesn't mean you don't fail sometimes. But it means that you have made a decision when you said yes to Jesus, that you made a decision that you would radically alter your life and go in a whole different direction. There's a fruit of repentance there. Number two is the fruit of the Spirit. You cannot be a follower of Jesus Christ without changing on the inside. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 to 23 says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, faith, meekness, temperance. When the Holy Spirit comes inside of you, it's not just about the rules on the outside, it's about the change on the inside. Your character becomes different. You start behaving different. You start thinking different, talking different. You start having compassion and love. It's not just about what you do on the outside. It's that you start changing who you are on the inside. That's the fruit of the Spirit. God is dwelling inside of you, changing the core of who you are. Listen to me. Changing churches does not save you. Well, Pastor, I used to be a Catholic, now I'm a new lifer. What? I think I'm right with God. No, you just changed seats. How does it make you right with God? The devil could sit in one of these chairs. Attending a service does not make you right with God. It just means that if you switch places of worship. What makes you right with God is not a denomination, not a church, not an auditorium. What makes you right with God is that you've come to the place of surrender to God and you've allowed Him to be Lord of your life and you have invited Him in so that He starts to change you from the inside out and you are changing as a person because He is working in your life because you've submitted to His Lordship and there is fruit, evidence of that transformation inside of your life. And I'm closing with this, wrapping it up. It's the fruit of influence or disciple making. Philippians chapter 1, verse 21 through 22, Paul said, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. But if I live in the flesh, this will mean fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which to choose. Listen, when Jesus called his disciples, he said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. You cannot be a disciple of Jesus without making other disciples of Jesus. If you are a disciple of Jesus, you will be salt and light where you go. Jesus said, if you're not salt and light, then what good is the salt and what good is the light? If you are a follower of Jesus, you will start having fruit that influences other people. In other words, if you come to Christ, it won't just be a personal thing. It'll be something that affects people around you. Others will come to Christ. You will influence others because a follower produces followers. A disciple makes disciples. Someone that's full of light will share the light. Someone that's salty will spread the salt. You will actually start influencing people around you in a positive way towards Christ because you will start showing the fruit of what it means to live for Jesus Christ. Disciples make disciples. So what is the evidence? The fruit of repentance, the fruit of the Spirit, and the fruit of impacting other people's lives. When someone, Jesus said, one seed is planted, and that one seed will produce 30 more seeds, or 60 more seeds, or 100 more. In other words, that if you truly are a follower, you will start showing the evidence and the fruit of being a genuine follower and not merely just a fan. It is my goal, so help me Jesus, my objective, not to fill an auditorium of spectators. I have no desire to fill an auditorium simply of people that are spectators or fans of Jesus. I have a desire to challenge people to be authentic, true followers of Christ. I want you to count the cost and say, am I really following Jesus? I want to push you to the next level. I want to call you out to be an authentic follower of Christ and not just a fair weather fan of the things of God. Now hear me well. I believe as a church, we'll always be reaching out to people around us, and there'll always be people among us that are still fans because they haven't chosen to be followers yet. And I understand that. And if you're here today and you're just a fan, I'm glad you're here. But I don't want you to stay a fan forever. You enter as a fan, but hopefully if you stick around, you're going to really decide to be a follower. How about it? So my challenge today is I want everybody to ask themselves this question: am I a fruitful follower of Christ? And if I'm not, then when am I going to take the step to move from just being a fan to being an authentic follower? Ba 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 ba.